2017 is a year of open doors. Somebody say it with me. A year of open doors. The Holy Spirit has spoken to us that He's going to open doors in our lives and in our church that we wouldn't have even known to ask Him for. God wants to do some new things. Amen. I want you, if you will, to just direct your attention to the screen for a moment.
I have this weight on my shoulders.
And can you expound on that a little bit deeper for me, please?
It's like something's picking me apart all the time, like pick, pick, pick. It's like this constant nagging, you know, like...
Oh.
Does what I'm saying make sense at all?
You know you have a monkey on your back?
Yes, that's exactly how I feel.
No, I don't think you understand. What I'm saying is you have an actual monkey on your back, and I think if you just removed it...
Really?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I thought coming to a professional, you could actually help.
You know, why don't we just reset here for a minute? Is there anything else going on?
Yes. There's this odor around me I just can't get rid of.
You're feeding it.
Can you just calm down?
You're literally feeding the problem.
Put the pen down.
I'm not going to put the pen down.
Stop pointing it at me.
The pen is not the problem.
Sit back.
I'm sitting back. My back is against the back here.
Okay, let's stop all this monkey business and let's dig deep and really try to figure out what I need to do to fix my problem.
I'm going to ask you a question.
Okay.
What is it that you think you need to do?
I just don't know.
We're starting a new series this morning called Changed. And I don't know about you, but sometimes there are areas in our lives, if maybe we haven't focused on them, but we need change. We need to be willing to change.
Yes. Yes.
How many people in here today would raise your hand and say, you love change? All right, there's a few people that say they love change. That's awesome. Most of us, the majority of people, wouldn't raise our hand and say, yes, I love change. And we, you know, sometimes we have change and we like that change, but other changes we have, we don't love so much. Right? How many people in here have a favorite restaurant? Oh, come on, you're Christians. You ought to have a favorite restaurant if you go to church. We love eating. I like eating a lot of different places, but one place that I love to eat in Conneaut is Biscotti's. Yeah, so I love, if you haven't been to Biscotti's, you need to go down there because, man, what a wonderful, wonderful restaurant. It's absolutely delicious. Now, every time I go, I walk in and they tend to do something when I walk in that is totally and absolutely just does not matter at all. When I walk in, they put something in front of me called a menu. And I walk through this little farce. I actually open it up and look at it as though I'm actually considering something. I'm not thinking about ordering anything when I go to Biscotti's except for one thing, and that is my favorite dish at Biscotti's. It's what I always order. If you go there and you haven't ordered this, you need to go down there, and when you walk in, tell Lori, Pastor Carson told me to come down here and order this. It'll change your life, okay? When you go down there, you need to order chicken parmesan. It's really, really, really delicious. And so I always order chicken parmesan. I may read the menu and they could say they've got 13 specials over here and they got all this. And I'm going to go, I'll have the chicken parmesan. I always have the chicken parmesan. Now, there was only one time that I remember ever being at Biscotti's and I didn't have chicken parmesan. And that's when our overseer came and we took them out to dinner there and we were fasting. I was on the Daniel fast. So I went in and I said, I'll just have salad and water, please. And I sat and I watched the bishop, Greg, eat chicken parmesan. And And when you have a favorite dish at your favorite restaurant, what if you walked into your favorite restaurant and you ordered your favorite dish and they said, oh, our menu has changed and we don't serve that anymore. Not a change that I would be embracing. I was so happy to see they did a little roundtable on the public access channel, and they were just doing a little interview down at Biscotti's and talking about the restaurant. And they said, what is the one dish that is the most ordered? And people were talking about different things. And of all the dishes that are ordered, you know what the number one thing is that people order at Biscotti's? Chicken Parmesan. Because there's a lot of smart people in Conneaut, Ohio. Now, I'll tell you what. There are some changes in our life that we just don't want, and some changes that we begrudgingly embrace, but most people resist change. I want you to think about in yourself, you know, think about kind of your ideas about change in general and how resistant you are to change. You know, they say, the actual survey says that 1 out of 9 people, only 1 out of 9, will make a lifestyle change, like to their diet and exercise, even if they're told by their doctor that it will prolong their life, it'll restore their health, that it could reverse diabetes and hypertension and heart disease. Even being told that, only 1 out of 9 will actually make a change. Can you imagine that? 11% of people will say, I'm going to choose to make a change so that I live. 89% of people would choose death rather than change. Wow. We get stuck in our ways, don't we? And that's how we are. Because here's the deal with change. Change causes stress. Because we know what we know. We're creatures of habit. Anybody here a creature of habit? You get up at the same time and you have the same routine and the same order about your day, and this is what I do and this is how I do that. And we're very, very good at being comfortable, and it's very predictable. And it's not that that's wrong or that that's negative, but sometimes we are unwilling to even question why we do something a certain way. We're unwilling to question or to say, well, is there a reason why I'm doing this? When I meet with young couples who are going to get married, one thing that I tell young couples is, you have a singular opportunity when you get married. You don't get this opportunity again. Because when you get married, if you're leaving mom and dad's house and you're coming together, you're setting up a home. When you do this, you get to decide what is your home going to be like. What is going to be your daily routine? And can I tell you that the key to your destiny lies in your daily routine? Did you know that? If you look at the things that you do every day, and if you'd be willing to change your daily routine, you could change your trajectory and where you're heading. Is that good? Yeah. And so when couples come together, I say, you get to decide this now. But 6 months from now, after you're married and you've already set things up, it's going to be much more difficult to change. A year from now, it's going to be even harder. If you wait 5 years, it's almost like everything is set in cement. And so you have to determine what your marriage is going to be about. You have to set your priorities. And when you set your priorities, then you decide this is how we're going to order our lives. Because it's a priority for us to have a marriage that's based on the Word of God, we're going to read the Word of God together every day. Because we believe that the Holy Spirit wants to direct our lives and guide us and speak to us, we're going to pray together every day. Somebody ought to say amen right there. Because we believe that when we have those people that are around us that are speaking positively into our lives and that are giving us the word of God, we're going to make a commitment to be in church. We're going to make a commitment that when we have kids, we're going to raise them in church. We're going to make a commitment to serving. We're going to make a commitment that our lives, we're not going to go to sleep mad at each other. When couples come together, they can make these kind of decisions initially, but if you don't make them initially, it's very hard after you've done it a certain way. It's very hard to change. And even little changes cause us stress because we don't like our routine to be disrupted, do we? You know, I know some people that have talked to me about ministry and they have an idea of ministry and they say, Pastor, I want to do ministry. And the idea is when I get everything in my life all in order and everything is good and I've got all this set, then I'll let the Lord use me. Can I tell you, if you have that attitude towards serving the Lord, the devil will always give you plenty of excuses so that it's never going to be easy. Serving the Lord and walking in obedience in serving others, it is not convenient. It requires your schedule to change. It requires you to say, I'm willing to be a little bit uncomfortable. Yes, sir. Because the predictable brings us comfort. And now, some of you are saying, Pastor, you've been preaching up a storm and shouting and carrying on the last few weeks, and today there's not a whole lot to shout about. This will help grow us. Yeah. Okay? So I want us to grow a little bit. I was listening, and I don't even know what the context of the reason that they played this, but Jessica and I were just coming home the other night, and I was going through the radio stations, and one of the news stations played an old clip from Donald Rumsfeld. And he was in a press conference or something, and they were interviewing him, and this was back probably, I don't know, maybe somewhere around 10, 12 years ago, maybe longer, I guess probably longer than that, maybe 15 years ago. And they were asking him about, threats or something to the United States. And Donald Rumsfeld said, well, we have the known knowns. And the known knowns are things that we know that we know. Okay? And then he said, we have known unknowns. Those are things that we know that we don't know. And then he said, then we have the unknown unknowns, and those are things that we don't know that we don't know. Those are really scary. Yeah. See, sometimes you know what you know, and you might even know that there's something that you don't know, but then there's some things out there that you don't even know that you don't know. And the more we get into the unknown unknown, the more life changes, the more unpredictable that it becomes, the more stress that we have over it. But you know, Jesus did not call us to always live our lives in the known knowns. I heard that, and Jessica, I'm listening to that, I'm thinking, I mean, it sounds so funny, but then I'm starting to think about the logic of it, and then I'm thinking, Jesus didn't call us. We want to live in the known knowns. He's calling us to step out and to be willing to change and to get out of our comfort zone and to willingly say, God, would you change me? Now, for those of you that are already getting a little stressed and a little bit nervous, let me give you a little bit of peace and comfort and tell you this simple fact, and it is this. God never changes. How many are happy for that? We serve a God who, in a world that's changing all the time, I mean, the world's changing every single day, it seems like. There's just what the world that you and I, when we were young, that we grew up in, that's not the world we live in now. Right? You realize that, right? You realize when you send your kids to school, they're not having the same experience that you had when you went to school and you were their age. They're facing things that you and I never had to face. Our culture is rapidly changing. There are changes happening. Some of the changes in the world are good changes, and some of them are really bad changes. Sometimes we have things that used to be, we used to say, this is right and this is wrong, and now our world is so confused that they don't even know the difference anymore. Things are changing all the time. Technology is changing. And sometimes you think, I just can't even keep up. I just don't even know what's going on. It's just, I bought this and it was the latest, greatest thing. But that was 2 weeks ago. And now what was new and improved is old and inferior. And can I tell you, in the middle of all of that change, we serve a God who says, I'm the same yesterday, today, forever. I do not change. You need to have peace and comfort in knowing Him and in your relationship with Him. Not that God is old-fashioned. Sometimes people think, well, He doesn't change, so He's still just old-fashioned. No. You see, when we get to the end of all of our learning and all of what we can figure out and what we can know, when we get to the very climax of everything that man could come up with, then we will find Him, because He's already 10,000 light years past where we would even think. He doesn't change because there's no need for Him to change. He doesn't change because He is perfect. And it should cause you to have peace when you depend upon Him. Here's what He said in Malachi 3:6. I am the Lord and I do not change. And then He said something interesting. This is why you descendants of Jacob are not already destroyed. He said, you need to be so thankful that I'm not like you, because I have this grace, and because I don't change, I can see where you're at today, but I'm not going to just come down. Aren't you glad God doesn't have a big smite button up there? Yes. And just when we mess up, go zzz. Aren't you glad He hasn't dealt with us according to our iniquities, but that in Him He gives us that grace and He gives us His love? God does not change. You can trust Him. You can trust His word. Somebody say amen. But for the Christian, here's what God's unchangeableness also means. God doesn't change. But to us, that means that God's people need to be constantly changing. I said God's people need to be constantly changing. God doesn't change. The unchangeable one, the one that is, He's the same yesterday, today, forever. You know, the unchangeable one is the greatest agent of change that you'll ever encounter in your life. When you come into contact with Him, He will change you. When you come to know Jesus, He changes you. How many of you would testify and say, if you've given your life to the Lord and you've been saved, that He changed you, you're different now than who you used to be? That's good. That's what He does, isn't it? And we don't want to go back to who we used to be, right? Somebody say amen. Amen. And there are some people who resist that. There are some people that you know, that you talk to, who resist surrendering their life to the Lord because they don't want to change. And they know that if I surrender everything to the Lord, then I'm going to have to change some stuff. I'm going to have to change some things in my life, and they're not yet willing to make that decision. But here's the rub, everybody. Catch this. The change that Jesus wants to bring to your life doesn't all happen when you get saved.
That's right.
You right now, if you know Jesus, you should be in a process of change. You should not be now who you were 6 months ago. And 6 months from now, you should not be who you are today. He is constantly pushing us to change. Is that good?
Yes.
He wants you to grow and to stretch and to expand. He wants to do new things in your life. But the longer that we're saved, the more we resist change. Can I be honest about some things that happen in Christian culture? You know what happens in Christian culture? If you do something once, you know, it's kind of like, man, that's out there. You do it again, you do it the second time, and it becomes, okay, well, that's kind of neat. And then you do it for the third time, it becomes the routine. Once you do it about four or five times, it becomes, this is the way that we have to do it. Once you do it about six or eight times, it becomes holy. Really? And anybody who says that they want to do it any different, the immediate thing that would happen is, well, no, we never did it that way before. We have to be very careful in the body of Christ that everything is based on the Word and not just on our idea or what we have experienced or thinking that this is always how it has to be. As a matter of fact, sometimes I think that it's like when we got saved, time stopped. Whenever you got saved, they were singing certain songs. If you got saved a year ago, you know, they were singing certain songs a year ago. If you got saved 10 years ago, there were certain songs singing 10 years ago. If you gave your heart to the Lord 50 years ago, certain songs were singing 50 years ago. And whatever songs those were, those are the tend to be the songs that you think those are the great songs of the church. There's nothing like that. And we tend to think those are just so much better because God used those in us. But you know what? God wants to use something else, and there's something new, and God hasn't finished with His work in creation. He uses what's happening right now in His people to reach more people for Him. The message never, ever, ever changes. But the method of getting that message, it has to constantly change. And the church, you can see churches that get stuck in a certain thing, and they just are unwilling to change. Can I give you a personal example of this with me? You're kind of at my mercy, so it doesn't matter if you agree or not. I'm going to tell you anyway. For about 25 years of my life, I was a Windows PC guy. And I used Windows. I mean, I knew, and people would, you know, ask me about stuff, and I would know all the stuff, and a new version of Windows would come out, and I mean, I would take the computer apart and put it back together, and back in the day, you know, I was trying to push the computers to do things that they really were, you know, not quite ready to be able to do, and I wanted to do non-linear video editing back when it was all analog, and we're doing all kind of stuff with computers, and I was always a Windows guy. I was a guy that just, this was my thing. And I would look at Apple guys, had these Apple computers, and I would think, I don't know about those Apple people. You know, they're just kind of, you know, they don't really know. You know, I know all this stuff. They don't know all this. And they're just kind of creative types. And, you know, and the more that I looked at that, the more I thought, man, I kind of envy these Apple people. And I kind of thought, I'd like to try to be an Apple guy. But you know what? I was afraid to leave the comfort that I knew to change everything over. It was a difficult decision. And the state director in our state he's an Apple guy. And he told me, he said, Carson, here's what you do. He said, you just go buy you a little used MacBook, just cheap. And he said, try it out for a month or two. You don't have to get rid of the PC. Just try it out. See if you like it. You don't like it, just sell it. It's okay. And I thought, wow, that makes sense. So I started prophesying to my wife. And I said, Jessica, I'm just so glad you're going to buy me a MacBook. And then it changed. Then I said, oh, Jessica, I'm so happy because God's going to speak to you. You're going to buy me a MacBook Pro. You know, I started speaking the specifics of it over her. And I think she got more and more nervous. But the Lord worked it out, and we found a used MacBook Pro that somebody had. And one day I said, hey, I saw this. I found this on Craigslist. And she said, well, let's go get it. So I went and I got it, and I brought it home, and I thought, oh. You know, when I opened up the box, there was just music that went, oh, and kind of a glow came up. It was just one of these experiences. And I started trying to change. And what I found is I had a certain way of thinking that caused me to struggle in this transition and in this change. And one thing that I had is I had a program called Outlook. How many people use Outlook? All right, there's a few of you that use Outlook. And in Outlook, I had every contact of every person that I'd ever had contact with. I had every note that I had ever taken, all my notes in Outlook. I had every calendar appointment of my entire life for 15 years. I mean, if you ask me, what were you doing? You know, on November 18th, 1999, I can tell you because I've got it all. And I thought, I can't get rid of this. I've got to bring this over to my Mac. And I tried to sync it with my iPhone and my iPad. And every time that it synced, which was daily, Outlook would take all of my appointments and duplicate them. Make two of them. And if I waited a little while, it'd make three of them, and four of them, and five of them. And you know how I corrected that, right? I went through, and I went to every single calendar appointment for 15 years, and I deleted all of the duplicates. It took me hours and hours and hours, but I wanted to be perfect, because if somebody ever asked me, I've got a perfect calendar here. And then I thought, okay, I messed up in this. Now I've got this. Now it'll be fixed. And then the next day, guess what happened? Amen. Whew, just like rabbits, they all multiplied again. My contacts, some of you, it's like I loved you so much. I had you in Outlook like six different times, over and over and over and over. And I went through and had to edit all of them again. And then I thought, oh, I messed up here. Oh, I think if I do this, and I tried it again, and guess what happened the next day? There they went again. And I'm locking myself in my office for hours on end trying to make this work. Now, on my Apple, on my Mac, it had very simple programs to handle all these things, but I didn't trust them. And finally I said, I'm trying to find a solution. I'm calling different people. And somebody said, just use Mac. Mac's got all that. Just use. I'm like, but I always use Outlook. I'm like, just forget about Outlook. Throw those things over there. They'll work great. And man, I was afraid. Your pastor was operating in a spirit of fear. And then I decided, you know what? I told my wife, I said, I prayed about this. Now you think this is crazy, but I prayed about this, and I'm going to trust that this is going to work. I'm just going to try it. I made a backup of everything, and then I put everything over. And when I put everything over, you know what happened? It worked perfectly. I didn't have to think about it. It didn't duplicate anything. It didn't make a mess of it. It just worked for me. Now, you may not be an Apple person, and that's okay. I'm not here to, I don't make any money off somebody buying an Apple product. But to me, it was a spiritual experience. And here's what the Lord spoke to me. He said, there are things in your life that I'm trying to get you to do, and you are resisting and trying to force it back into the model that you have. And you are keeping yourself from what I have called you to. Now, I'm not going to tell you to trust Apple, because I don't trust Apple. But I am going to tell you, you can trust Him. Are you hearing me? And here's what I learned from that. My unwillingness to change can keep me from the greatness that God has for me. Would you catch this morning? My unwillingness to change and to be flexible and to say, God, whatever you want to do, you do that in me. If I'm unwilling, that will keep me from the great things that God has. How many know God's spoken greater things over this church? He's prophesied that He'll do greater things in Conneaut, Ohio. We cannot get to the point of greater things by doing the same thing that we've always done before.
Amen.
And if we're unwilling to have the Holy Spirit do that work of change, we forfeit the potential for what God wants to do in our lives. Is that good?
Yeah.
See, God loves us just the way we are, but he doesn't want to leave us where we are. He wants to take us to new places. God wants to take us to places we've never been before. But we have to willingly come to him and ask him to change us. And here's the scripture. Today's just the kind of the intro of this subject. Here's the scripture that I want us to really look at. And I want to encourage you to start praying this. It's one simple verse in Romans chapter 12, verse 2. Here's what Paul said. Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world. But let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. And then you'll learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. Now, if you read that in the King James, it says, and do not be conformed to this world. Now, here it says, don't copy the behavior. And really, that word conform is like a mold. It's like you just have a mold, and you take stuff, and you put it in there, and then it looks like whatever that impression from that mold is. And he said, you should not look like other people. There is a way of thinking in the world, and it should not be in the church.
That's right, man.
Love.
Yeah.
The world has, and we live in a culture in the United States of America of independence and of freedom. I can do whatever I want to do. In the church, it ought not to be that way. We should not have the same perception of anything as the world has. We can look at the world and go, yeah, the world thinks this. What does God's word say? Because God wants to change me. And he says, but let God transform you. The word there is in Greek is where we get our word metamorphosis. Let him cause you to be in this process of change. And here's, I don't talk a lot about, because I know a lot of people don't get into this, but in the Greek, the verb here is in the present passive imperative tense. Greek has so many verb tenses that we don't have. We just see a word and we see a simple verb, but you really don't get what they're saying. And it's a very different kind of verb tense. It is a command. It is a verb that says God is commanding you not to do it. See, sometimes people say, God's commanding me to think this way. He's not. He's commanding you to, and then it's passive. So it's an imperative passive. Are you catching me? The imperative is the command. The passive means I'm not doing it. Are you with me? There's a few heads nodding and a bunch of people looking at me like... It means God is commanding you that you allow him to do it. God is saying, I'm telling you, my church, you have to allow me to change the way that you think. You have to say to him, God, I don't want to think the thoughts that I have. I don't want to think the way the world thinks. I don't want to use the model or the mold that somebody else is in. God, I want you to transform me and shape me and mold me. I have a mentor in my life, Marty Baker. Marty is an incredible pastor. Pastors down in Augusta, and I love Marty Baker. I love just hanging around him. Man, when he starts to speak, I listen to Marty speak, and I think, wow, he's on a whole different level. And here's one thing that I've heard Marty say so many times. Get this. I think this would be a really good prayer to pray. Here's what Marty says. And he's told his church this. We need to think new thoughts. We need to think new thoughts. Now that is totally scriptural. Because he says if we're going to be changed, he does it by changing the way you think. Our minds need to be renewed. You know, that doesn't come by just going through the same thing over and over and over. It doesn't come in a place of comfort and predictability. It comes in spending time with the Holy Spirit and asking Him, Lord, would You change the way that I think? You know, every time you read this book will change you if you'll allow it. When you read God's Word, it will change you from the inside out. Here's what I have to be careful of. I think, oh, here's what we should do, and we'll just go off on that path. And then I get on down that path, and then the Lord will speak to me and say, hey, you didn't ask me. This might seem really good over here, but you need to just press the pause button here, and you need to come back to me, and you need to pray, and you need to seek me, because I've got a plan for you. Last point, the Holy Spirit wants to bring God change. God change. I'm not talking about just any change. The Holy Spirit in your life wants to bring you God change. He wants to transform you from glory to glory to glory to glory. How does that come? It comes from first, Him changing the way we think. We've got to change in our minds, church. God change is rarely comfortable. It requires stepping out in faith. It requires trusting Him. It requires that when you are in the safety and the comfort of the boat, and He says, step on out of the boat, you can walk on water, that you just go, okay, I'm coming out, and you throw your leg over the side of the boat. Never saw anybody do that before. But God, I'll trust You. Can I submit to You? God wants to bring some change. And I love the little video that I showed you a few minutes ago. The counselor asked him this question. What do you think you need to do? That's a really, really counselor-like kind of thing to say, isn't it? Well, what do you think you need to do? But I want to ask you that today. Because the Holy Spirit's probably been dealing with you about something. The Holy Spirit's probably been talking to you about an area of your life. The Holy Spirit has probably been prompting you. Maybe He's been prompting you through a sermon, or maybe He's been prompting you when you read the Word, or maybe He's been prompting you through a spiritual mentor in your life saying, no, I think you really need to consider this. Maybe the Holy Spirit has been whispering to you about an area. Maybe He's spoken to you in your prayer time. What is it that the Holy Spirit's been speaking to you that you need to allow Him to change? Are you hearing that this morning? And maybe it's an area of obedience to the Lord. Maybe God's calling you to do something and you think, but I can't do that. But I'm not ready. I don't know how that'll turn out. Maybe it's an area where the Holy Spirit has been directing you in your marriage and you just don't want to humble yourself in your relationship. Maybe it's an area about witnessing and sharing your faith with other people. Maybe it's something to do with where you work. Maybe it's an attitude that you have, and you know you got a bad attitude. You don't have an attitude that's submitted to the Holy Spirit. Maybe the Lord's been speaking to you about this book right here and that you need to get in this book more. Maybe He's been speaking to you about your prayer life or your lack of a prayer life. Maybe He's been speaking to you about serving. Maybe He's been speaking to you about giving. Maybe He's been speaking to you about your finances. I don't know what He's been talking to you about. But here's what I want to tell you. 2017 is a year of open doors. And God wants to do some things that right now you wouldn't even know. And if we are unwilling to change, we could forfeit them. If we're unwilling to allow the Holy Spirit, and sometimes we say, oh, it's not that big a thing. It's just this over here. But if we'll get that area in line, it will line us up with what God wants to do. Can I ask you this? What if this week, what if this church spent this week every day going to God. And I want to encourage you. Here's some things you could pray. If you want to write something down, write this down and then pray some things this week. What if every day you said, God, what do you want to change in me today? God, what do you want to change in me today? What if every day we evaluated our daily routine and started to ask why? What if we evaluated our daily routine and said, why do I spend so much time on this? I say that I love the Lord, but if you looked at my daily routine, would it show you that? Because the key to your destiny is hidden in your daily routine. What if we ask God to conform us to His image this week? What if I said, Lord, conform me to Your image? Lord, conform me to who You are. Want me to give you a dangerous one? What if you said, Holy Spirit, evaluate my thought life. What are the thoughts that I'm allowing that are in my mind that are holding me back from the greatness You have for me? Here's what I want us to pray. All those things really come down to this. God, change me. Change me. Change me. Change. I want God change. All of us could have an idea of something we could do to change. I'm not talking about that. I want God change. I want the Holy Spirit directing. I want Him leading. I want Him guiding. Some of you are saying, Pastor, you've been shouting and screaming and carrying on the last few weeks, and now this one, man, this is a whole lot different. That's okay. Transformation comes when we willingly come to Him and just say, Lord, would You transform me? God, do a deeper work in me. It's great that we shout. It's great that we have a good time. But listen, it's not how high you can jump when you shout. It's do you walk straight when you land? Right? I'm going to ask you this morning, if we could have just a moment that we pray together and that we ask the Lord, God, do that work of change in me. Would you stand? I want you to do something a little different this morning. I want you to make physical contact with somebody. Grab their hand, reach over, put your hand on their shoulder, or hold their hand this morning. And if you see someone that's by themselves, you might need to stretch across an aisle. Make sure no one is alone. Make sure everybody's got somebody. And if you don't know them by name, ask them right now, what's your name? Make sure you know that person by name. And remember their name, because here's your assignment. You're going to pray for them by name right now. So that every person that's here, when you walk out, you're going to have someone who has prayed over you today. I want you to pray for that person, because this can be a very stressful, very tough thing, what we're asking the Lord to do. Lord, conform me. It's going to be some pressure that's put. There's going to be some change that He requires. He's going to do a new thing, and that can cause some stress. So I want you to pray for him. And then we're each of us going to say to the Lord, Lord, here I am. I want You to change me. Can we do that? Let's pray right now for one another. Father, we come before You. Lord, I thank You for the body of Christ, because in this body, Lord, we lift one another up as You've called us to. We pray for one another. And right now, we call out one another's name out loud to You. We pray, Lord, that Your hand would be upon our brother and our sister, Lord, this week specifically, as we're asking You to change us. Lord, it may be stressful and it may be difficult. It may be challenging, but Lord, it is worth it. It is worth it. worth it. It is worth it to allow you to do the work you desire to do in us. So, Lord, now we just come to you and we say, God, here I am. Change me. Holy Spirit, evaluate my thought life. Lord, that you would illuminate my mind. Lord, that the eyes of my understanding would be enlightened so that I would be able to line up more with your word. God, help me to change the way that I think by submitting to your Holy Spirit. God, I pray that you would do a deep work in me. Lord, I pray that my daily routine is going to change. Help me to not just live comfortably.
Thank you, Jesus.
Holy Spirit, I invite you to stretch me, to do a new thing in me. God, in this year of open doors, I pray you're going to open doors that we wouldn't have even known to ask you for, and it's going to be because of our obedience. Because of our obedience, Lord, to what you are saying. Holy Spirit, change us. Change us. Change us. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. God, we give ourselves to you. We are yours. Hallelujah. 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 We are not our own. We belong to him.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Lord, I thank you that you've heard those prayers. I thank you, Lord, that you are answering. And God, that you're going to do greater things, greater things, greater things. Hallelujah. 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 Yeah, somebody praise him. As our elders and their wives, our leaders come, if they will, to pray. If you need prayer this morning, they're going to be here. But let me just share with you, this starts a process. And I want to encourage you, it's not easy, but it's worth it. I said, it's not easy, but it's worth it.
Amen.
To ask the Lord to change us. So I'm going to encourage you this week, begin to allow the Holy Spirit to do that work in you. As he's doing that work in you, you'll be amazed. Because he's going to be doing that work in our church and in your family, in your spouse, in your kids. We're going to be asking the Lord over these next several weeks, God, change us. Help me to not be the same person. Wow. That's exciting, isn't it? A little bit stressful, but we'll pray our way through the stress.